I'm honored to be here today at this critical juncture in the life of your nation, and to be here in this remarkable university, which has launched the careers of heads of state and has most critically nurtured the yearnings of the angelic rebellions of dissident poets. I'm most grateful for the kind words of introduction by your committed vice president and for his invitation to participate, to partner, and I hope to also provoke. The air here in Addis is supercharged with an energy that is generated by the hope for meaningful change, despite all the uncertainty that always accompanies such changes. I'm in this venue precisely because Addis University's student body has, over its history, channeled those very energies to construct an active citizenship, from delivering literacy programs under the emperor to stirring up a student movement that lit a fire clear across this continent at a time of earlier revolutionary transformation and change. At the heart of my reflections this afternoon will be the central question of citizenship. So there is no better place to interrogate that matter than this arena of ideas, which has been the site of so many important historical and contemporary conversations about African freedom, unity, peace, and security, where so many of you are busy even right now, dreaming up bold plans and schemes for the future of your continent. Citizenship is the matter of the day. But as I consider the privilege of citizenship in this context, I'm compelled to do that by locating it within constitutionalism and within culture, and to consider how one might reconcile the tension between the two. This is my fourth trip into Addis over the course of the last year, and I'm really starting to know my way around a bit. But I must confess that I had a bit of a head start because truth be told, over the last many years, I have been living in the 10th region of Ethiopia, which is better known as Washington, D.C., which is, of course, the home of a vibrant and robust diaspora community. I've spent many evenings in Washington enjoying Ethiopian food and Ethiopian jazz, but of course, the greatest epiphanies come when you're able to trace a river right back to its source. Let me start by stating the obvious, if I can. I'm not Ethiopian. The Open Society Foundations that I am privileged and blessed to lead is not an Ethiopian institution. I'm beginning with this rather obvious declaration because these days, the historical conspiratorial broadsides that sit and rest comfortably on social media seem to always enter into every room before rational discourse can. The very nature of our mission to hold power to account seems to lend itself to these distortions in the toxic wasteland that much of the internet has become. The best disinfectant for such sludge is transparency. And so it's essential to take a few minutes to define our work and the intent of our investments and partnerships here in your beloved country. Because I am not of your soil or of your community, it's important that I announce my intent for my door knock before you open your door to serve me some coffee. The Open Society Foundation seeks to build vibrant and tolerant societies whose governments are accountable and open to the participation of all people. We believe that such societies are more stable and more prosperous. We are the largest funder of civil society actors who work to promote rights and to protect the interests of the most marginalized communities around the world. In all of the places where we are engaged, we are led by local advisories, and we depend on their homegrown knowledge and their own independent grant making. We enter spaces with profound humility and with due deference, and always, always in full consideration of our own fallibility. That is certainly the case today as we knock on your door here in Addis. We're here to support democratic reforms, to the extent that they help to realize the wishes and the aspirations of the Ethiopian people. We cannot prescribe and have no intention of prescribing to Ethiopians what kind of government they should have. We are here to support the process and institutions to sustain democratic progress. We're committed to support efforts and processes that promote tolerance in societies and to that extent realize the need to uphold pluralism, cultural or ethnic or otherwise, and inclusivity because we believe that ultimately the inclusion of all citizens as critical stakeholders in the national economic development and governance process ultimately increases strength, stability, and progress for all. Our commitment is to support a reform agenda that is led by the Ethiopian people towards a more stable and prosperous nation. As we do this, we find avenues for partnership with average citizens and with government. But let me be clear, our partnerships with government will not be uncritical as we continuously probe to assure that the open window for reform does not instead become window dressing. In my engagements here, I've had the honor to break bread with Prime Minister Abiy, whose sincerity as a reformer has been an inspiration and an invitation to partner with authenticity and with a questioning rigor. I've observed that Dr. Abiy has a fondness for metaphors, and one that he employs with some reliable consistency for me has become something of a metaphor for this broad question of citizenship, citizen engagement, citizen action, and citizen agency. It is the story that Dr. Abiy tells about Nkulal, the egg. In his words, if an egg is cracked on the outside by an external hand, the life inside that egg might be stillborn and destroyed. However, if the egg is cracked from inside, life happens and the world is reborn. You, particularly the young students here in this university, you are the beak that must crack that egg from the inside. My experience in politics and public policy tells me that it is incredibly hard to make hope and history rhyme. Pessimism is an easier choice, and there's much less sacrifices to be made if one takes the dispassionate posture of a critic at your keyboards. But Ethiopia's success and its inclusive future lies in your pecking from within at the hard shell that will continue to resist democratic transformation. It's my place only to provide support for the energy of your pecking and for the agency of your citizenship. I'm joined in that support by my brilliant colleagues who are here from Open Society Initiative from East Africa and our regional Africa office, who are spending this week learning about developments in the Horn, which Ethiopia today exemplifies. As all of our African entities for Open Society Foundations are rethinking their set of strategies, it is right and it is appropriate that they do so from this advantage perch that we receive when we're here in Ethiopia. Kwame Nkrumah, the former Ghanaian president, who helped create the Organization of African Unity, which of course became the African Union, believed fervently in the dream of Ethiopia, which he declared would rise to remold with all of us the full figure and the hopes and destiny of the African continent. His vision holds true today and should motivate all of us to reach beyond our fears and uncertainty to seize the potential of this current moment of change. So much seems possible today in a way that we could not have imagined over a year ago when I came through Addis on my way to Bahidar. About a year ago, I encountered a young man who was helping with my transport. And that young man was bursting to convey to this stranger his excitement at a moment when the new government was coming into formation. I asked him how he could place so much of his belief in an untested leadership that was moving into a volatile space. He said in a tone I will long remember, "Sir, I do not put my belief in them. I'm excited because for the first time, I believe in myself. That, I think, is the purest expression that you could possibly have of citizenship. And I would say that that young man's faith has produced change. The 18-year conflict with Eritrea has ended. Thousands of political prisoners have been released. Last year, the Committee to Protect Journalists reported that for the first time since 2004, Ethiopia has no journalists in jail. According to the 2019 World Press Freedom Index, Ethiopia rose 40 places in rank in 1 year alone. The improvement is so striking that the United Nations is hosting tomorrow the World Press Freedom Conference in Ethiopia. That was unimaginable a year ago, a year and a half ago only. Ethiopian women are taking up the challenge of contributing to the change process ahead. Last year, of course, Ethiopia's parliament famously elected its first female president, and women now make up half the cabinet. Women's rights activist Mirza Ashinafi heads the Supreme Court. And thus the brave Bertukan Medeska, the sole female opposition party leader and former detainee, is now responsible for moving Ethiopia safely through its first election in this open and therefore highly contentious time. Apart from efforts to reconcile vital public institutions like the judiciary and the electoral management body, deep legal reforms are currently underway. Of particular importance to all of us at the Open Society Foundations is the New Charities and Societies Proclamation approved by the House of People's Representatives in February that makes it possible for civic actors and civil society to operate more freely and, importantly, engage meaningfully and directly in the transition and to put their hand and their shoulders to the wheel of change. While Ethiopia has a rich tradition of intellectual engagement within its ruling party and coalition, civic energies, ideas, and organizing are now also sorely needed to engage with this transitional moment, to go beyond the framing of interests and needs in purely ethnic identity terms. The government has set up the Boundaries and Identity Issues Commission and the Reconciliation Commission. Significant steps if, and only if, well-articulated and seized to help ease real political tensions across legitimate grievances across the country. Finally, the heated debates amongst Ethiopia's youth and intellectuals about the possible directions and the political pitfalls of economic reform hold out hope of building on the previous gains of fighting poverty and reducing inequality, which is the scourge of this generation and the scourge of the planet. When we think about this generation of active protesters, of the courageous Kiro of Oromia region and their counterparts in Amhara, Southern Nations, and in other regions, we know the biggest challenge of this moment is meeting those demands and needs, not just for political inclusion, but also, and most especially, for economic inclusion. The protection and growth of their employment and livelihood possibilities, and that these heated debates of economic reform must be kept front and center if real democratic participation and real citizenship is possible. Citizenship is impossible when we have asymmetries of power and when we have gaps and asymmetries of economic inclusion and possibility. This transitional moment has been made possible by the bold pivot and realignment of the ruling coalition that was really spurred in response to pent-up frustration, pent-up demands of citizenship, which enabled this current prime minister to emerge. It is my sense that he's well aware of the tensions that this pivot and realignment have opened up and is committed to facilitating all the change processes mentioned above. But just as civic energies, ideas, and organizing have been poured into the new law reform effort, they need to also be poured into the process of political dialogue. That is the only way that one can address past grievances and engage with what Ethiopia's economic direction is going to be, and to decide ultimately who's going to be able to benefit from that direction. The world is watching with bated breath and with enormous expectation to see what happens next. No pressure, Ethiopia. We're cheering you on, and we're seeking to make certain that this change is lasting and deeply meaningful. But the challenge now is to maintain the gaze of justice and to maintain the momentum of change. And for the students and intellectuals at this university, as well with your regional counterparts, for you to play your historic role in providing intellectual energies, ideas, and organizing to address the real challenges and tensions of the time, and yet push forward on the road to realization of Ethiopia and Ethiopians' fullest potential within the region, and we hope within a broader context, continental context as well. This momentum must be solidified through the eventual administration of elections that are free and open to all, and that are fair to majorities and to opposition groups. This will be the opportunity to obtain political settlements that will enable a new governing dynamic that rejects the zero-sum absolutism of the deadly past. That's where governing mandates flow, as 100 million Ethiopians express their individual preferences in an act that affirms institutions by first concretizing individual citizenship. It is the moment of electoral participation that will open up the covenant and the arc of the Constitution for lasting reform. And that's when things are going to get interesting here. It's true that constitutional reformation is the key to overcome the limits that are enshrined in the dispensation of 1994. However, in order to move beyond the internal inconsistencies in the Constitution, there will be a need to directly engage issues of culture and community that defy the regulations of parliaments and courts. Demographic diversity is a blessing that is easily twisted into a curse by skilled politicians who ruthlessly understand that nationalism has always been the most potent mobilizing political force in history. The next federal election in Ethiopia is the great opportunity not to be defeated by the snake of nationalism that is bespoke from community to community, but to instead elevate an empathetic inclusion as the principal democratic currency here. Empathy builds solidarity that leads to a nationhood not dependent upon the diminished dignity of minorities. As you walk this path, the Open Society Foundations will walk beside you as a partner moving toward a vibrant, just, prosperous, and inclusive democracy. This is not just because Ethiopia is such a critical player in the Horn, in the Nile Basin, and the broader continent. We are certainly not unaware of the fragility of this transitional moment, the understandable anger, fear, and the nervousness across the country. But we believe two things. First, that Ethiopia's experience is not unique. We have seen and invested in exactly these kinds of moments before. From South Africa post-apartheid, to Liberia, Sierra Leone post-conflict, to Tunisia post-evolution, and now in the Sudan as that revolution rocks on. We have done this not only in Africa, but also in the post-Soviet states of Central and Eastern Europe, in Myanmar, in Asia, and on and on and on. There is a reason why the Open Society Foundation is proudly the enemy of authoritarians everywhere. We have learned from these investments over time. We know that investing in genuine attempts to reconstitute the public institutions to be rights respecting cannot be taken for granted. To enable those committed to and engage in the transition to deliver on the supply side to their people, but we also know that now few transitional governments can succeed without sustained demand from the people, of the people, by the people. Without the constructive engagement of civic energies, ideas, and organizing in the reimagining of the state. And also without the reminder to the state from the civic sector that it better deliver. This is why we'll be making a significant investment in all of the institutional reform processes that I rehearsed earlier, to contribute to enabling the inspiring leadership of those institutions to meet the many challenges that we know lie before them. But we will also be making a significant investment and rebuilding the capacities within the civic spaces here and civil society in Ethiopia to support the autonomous and independent organizing of Ethiopians, to enable them to put their views forward about this reform process, and to sustain the demand and the pressure to deliver. We are absolutely committed to not only talking the talk, but walking that walk with you. Let me tell you what that commitment looks like in some delineated terms, if I can. In the coming weeks, Umburu and the Open Society Initiative for East Africa will open up a new office, a brand new office here in Addis, and we hope to have it up and running in June. Open Society, through coordination by our regional Africa office, is also making a significant two-year investment in the government of Ethiopia, the private sector, and in civil society. We will support its legal reform efforts to improve police training, practice, and accountability, and to deliver on the National Human Rights Action Plan. We will fund a rights management unit, enabling it to better coordinate donor inputs to prepare for free and credible elections in 2020. We will fund the design and implementation of a new digital identity platform intended to secure social protection and other citizenship rights and benefits. And of particular interest to those who are gathered here today, I would think, we plan to take advantage of the fully more than 100 young Ethiopian alumni who have already received master's degrees and doctorates with the help of our Open Society Scholarship Program. We will explore ways to integrate them into our work with the government and civil society to add capacity where deficits now are incredibly plain. These efforts will involve engagement in Ethiopia from many, many corners of the Open Society network. From our justice initiative, to our international migration program, to our economic justice program, and others. In other words, we're making a full-on commitment here. We are also under absolutely no illusion that the road that we're traveling together is going to be one that is only in daylight and easy to navigate. The 2020 elections on the horizon will test this nation's cohesion and its true commitment to reform. We know from long experience how elections aggravate political, economic, and social fragmentation that already exists. And already we are seeing these divides play out here through the dislocation of 1 million Ethiopians who are considered refugees in their own nation. We know that the legacy of authoritarianism runs deep, and its pernicious effects are never, ever far behind. when I had a conversation with your prime minister some days ago this week, he walked me through the grounds of the executive, and he reminded me of some of the difficult histories that played out in that space. He pointed me towards a chamber where Emperor Haile Selassie was assassinated. He pointed me towards another space where those who hungered and thirsted and worked for righteousness and justice were tortured on the grounds, on the executive compound. And he talked about how difficult it's going to be to root out and extract that tint, that element of authoritarianism from the DNA of the politics. And he said to me, you know, Patrick, in spaces where people have grown accustomed to violence and political murder, one cannot even trust your own shadow on the ground. It's an interesting comment that he made to me about a kind of daily accountability that he has to attend to in himself in order to properly govern. We know how fragile this nation's nascent peace is, how delicate the balance of Ethiopia's competing national and subnational identities can be, and how hard it will be to prevent extreme ethno-nationalism from limiting all that can be achieved here. We know the economic challenges ahead, the impatience of your generation across the country who are unemployed and who are underemployed, the crushing burden of Ethiopia's $1 billion in debt, and the constant threat that corruption must be kept at bay. And we know we have our work cut out for us in helping to rebuild civic society, which has been so weakened by years of repression, and in helping to shore up public institutions crucial to ensure that reform is not fleeting, but long-lasting and secure. But we're ready to help you take those challenges and to tackle them head on, because we believe that the wind is at our backs. We believe in building ordinary Ethiopians' ability to engage in the transformation of your own country. We will support civic education and robust public policy debates to create avenues for Ethiopians to have a say in the present and in the future within the party and state and outside of the party and state. As I said, we have worked in countries at similar crossroads before. We have learned about the power of local voices and pledged to always work with and to honor the experiences of those at the front lines of reform. I had a public conversation with the Deputy Attorney General of your country, and in that conversation, he reminded me of his own experiences as a graduate student at a Central European University in Hungary, where he discovered that he was in this national bubble with intellectuals who spoke with some real fervor about a set of reforms and progress that they believed was assured to them, but they were having that conversation in a way that was utterly divorced from the grassroots. And the Deputy Attorney General was looking to us in open society to make certain that that connectivity, that interstitial tissue between leadership and the grassroots is always maintained and strengthened. Because Ethiopians themselves must crack that egg. We are only at this moment of new leadership and openness because of your courage and because of your resilience. You took to the streets. You demanded a new life and you demanded your full citizenship. This is what we have been hearing Ethiopians say about their hopes and dreams for the future. One, they would like to see clearly an effective separation of powers together with checks and balances, including an effective opposition and a pluralistic media that respects all Ethiopians. Two, they have told us in our exchanges that they're looking for a greater inclusion of all, not just ethnicities and regions, but also women, sexual minorities, and people with disabilities. Three, they've talked with a clarity about the need for economic justice and an economic model defined by Ethiopians themselves and not by outsiders, an economic model that benefits Ethiopians, and a model that builds on the anti-poverty, equality, and livelihood gains that have been realized and achieved thus far. Four, they want to see an Ethiopia that is a responsible regional anchor state that takes its rightful place within the continent and stands with other African nations at a time when vital institutions need to be reaffirmed up and down this incredible continent. Achieving these goals will take patience and hard work. We are all too familiar with your neighbors on this continent who've seen hope flower only to have it tested time and time again by corruption and by controversy. We've seen it in Zimbabwe, in Kenya, in Nigeria, and in my birthplace, the DRC. We've seen elections marred by flawed counts, recounts, disputes, and challenges. We've seen the threat of violence upend the promise of democracy. But we've also seen the power of the people. We've seen your ability to make life happen and to renew the world. Yesterday, I snuck away from my colleagues in their retreat. I got away for a few hours and I went out to the community of Hala, which I went to a space that can only be described as a former dumping ground. It's a former dumping ground. People just threw their waste generation after generation in that community. It became a wasteland. But this is where vision and courage come together to crack the egg. The artist and architect Elias Sime and anthropologist Meskarim Azogud didn't see a wasteland. They saw and then conceived a place of renewal. They converted that dump spot, that dump wasteland, into an open-air museum and sustainable farmland and garden where children learn and take responsibility for the future, and where community and who owns land is redefined. They're cracking that egg. As I was being introduced, and if you hadn't Googled me already, you learned that I had the good fortune to serve in the administration of Barack Obama as an ambassador and as a senior advisor to the president and director of his Office of Political Affairs. President Obama was, of course, the first son of Africa to become the president of the United States, and he was the first sitting American president to visit Ethiopia. During his visit, he stressed the importance of opening up space for independent journalists and for opposition voices in strengthening any society. Quote, when all voices are being heard, when people know that they're included in the political process, he said on that visit, that makes a country stronger and more successful and more innovative. That was true in the summer of 2015, and we're seeing the fruits of that truth advance in democratic dispensation in 2019 in Ethiopia. All of us in the Open Society Foundation, as we lean in to participate, to partner, and to provoke, we're all very much looking forward to see what emerges from that egg. Thank you so very much.